I would like to thank everyone for tuning in to the Backstage Show with yours truly, Karl Perazzo, here on the Music Channel. On today's show, we have a very special guest from Chile, a very passionate musician, guitar player who goes by the name Cigarboxman. Cigarboxman is very well known for playing a Native American cigar box guitar made from all recycled materials. The sound of the cigar box guitar is a rich and unique mix between Great Depression blues and 1970s psychedelic rock. Please welcome Cigarboxman.
Man, I can't thank you enough for being here.
Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Thank you for having me here.
You've come a long way, man, and welcome to our humble San Francisco Bay Area.
I love it.
So you go by the name of Cigarboxman.
Yeah, that's right.
And what do they call you for short?
Down in Chile, they call me Cigarrito. How you would say that in English, like
a little cigarette. Yeah, a little cigarette. That's funny because I'm from the Mission District and they used to call me Foforito, a little match. So,
that matched perfectly.
Yeah, but that was for another reason, I'll tell you. But I appreciate you being here, and what an honor and a joy to have and really show off your talents, man, with such a unique instrument, you know. But I want to know, how long have you been playing music, and was guitar your first instrument?
I have been playing since I was 11, I think. And the first thing that I played was the piano, actually. I was hearing Coldplay on the radio. I was hearing Coldplay. Clocks. I remember that time. And I asked to my father, can I play that on the keyboard? And he told me, yeah, come with me to the academy, because my father used to go to the academy to learn music. Mm-hmm. He would play guitar all days. So I saw him playing the guitar, and I wanted to do music with him, and I started with the keyboards, and afterwards I started with the bass, and afterwards with the guitar. That was my way into the music. Mm-hmm. So yeah, my father is a big figure in my music career.
So a big influence to you in your
career. Yeah.
And were there any other influences outside of your father and just radio music, or your mom was a musician, or
no,
any other of your family?
No, actually, my father was the first one in the whole family, from my mother and my father's sides, that start playing an instrument. And he was such a big figure when I was a little boy, and for me and for my brother as well. My brother played really good the drums, so we would play the three of us together. And was so much fun because the band that was me, my brother, and my father, we presented a lot of times live with this academy, and was great to play with both of them. We don't have the time now to get together and perform live and all the stuff. My brother is living outside Chile. I would probably live here in a couple of months. But it was really good fun. Yeah,
I had the same thing. You know, my mother and my father and my sister, we also had a band. When I was very young, and we used to play, you know, small venues, and you know, more like a competition or some kind of battle of the bands or something like that. I was really young, but you talk about, you know, there's musical influences, and there's the influence of being around your father and watching him learn and doing the same thing that he loves to do, sharing that moment. Those are real important, inspirational. For me, it was playing music with my parents and my sister, you know, and even my cousins. That was more of the experience than things you never forget, you know.
Yeah, exactly.
It's so important for that bond, right?
Yeah.
That bond. And then, so you're growing up playing music and you're playing guitar, and then...
And then suddenly found that instrument in my way, yeah.
You found the cigar box guitar.
Oh, yeah.
And who was the very first person that you heard play the cigar box guitar?
Was a really talented musician from Australia that is called Juicy Smith. Yeah, he played a lot on the streets, mm-hmm. but I saw him perform live in Woodford Festival in Australia, and I was playing there as well. So after his show, I went to talk with him. And we spent a couple of minutes talking in the backstage, and was such an incredible experience. I think it was like 5 minutes, and for me was like 1 hour of knowledge, you know, because
sure.
he teach me this bond between an organic instrument that you would make yourself and the music and the sound and the tone you will get from it. So it just opened my mind in a different way that I haven't seen music like that before. So,
or heard music.
Yeah, or hear music as well. Yeah, because the sound of the slide, it just really gets me from deep inside, you know. It kind of entered direct to my heart, you know. And
absolutely.
And I never felt like that with, electric or acoustic guitar in finger picking or picking. So I instantly felt like this was my way into the music. Because I have never been like a big guitar player, you know, like good guitar player. I was too slow with my fingers. And afterwards, I found out the slide, and I start practicing that way. And I instantly find out, okay, this is my instrument. I love how it sounds. I know how to play. I feel the instrument inside of me. And also, I am left-handed, so. And I learned the guitar in the right way, you know.
Yeah.
So, was very difficult for my left hand, and for somehow with the slide was easy, was really easy to do it. So that also opened me a way. And yeah, Jussie Smith was the first musician I saw performing live at Cigarbox guitar.
And you know, you talk about how the instrument touched you, and it, you know, at one point we are going to experience that if we allow it to happen, right? If some people miss the train, you know, but it really has a lot to do with sound, resonance, and vibration, and something that attracts you to this instrument, because it's a very neglected instrument. This is 1800s, 1840, 1860, American. You know, Depression blues, basically.
Yeah.
Deep South, Mississippi, you know, Bo Diddley, Lightning Hopkins. Their message really came across with that kind of tone.
Yeah.
You know? And did you study any of those guys, or?
Yeah. I wasn't into the blues world by the time I saw for the first time the Cigarbox guitar. And afterwards, I instantly start listening more blues because I wanted to hear what those musicians wanted to say with this roots vibe, this vibe of constructing yourself, your own tone, and with this vibe or being creative, you know. I think that being creative is one of the main things that really attract me to this instrument, because these guys didn't have anything, you know. The first people that start playing the Cigarbox guitar, they were really poor. They didn't have money to spend in instruments, so they start building this kind of instruments. And I think that's beautiful, and that's amazing. So I start listening more blues, I start listening to Robert Johnson, I start listening to Yonely Hooker, I start listening to Sonny Boy Williamson. And yeah, I mean, a lot of old blues roots movement, mm-hmm. but also without stop listening what I like it most, that was like this kind of 70s psychedelic rock. And my goal, and is still my goal, is fusion these mm-hmm. two worlds in a really unique way. And taking the roots, the very roots of the blues, and mixing with more modern resources.
That's fascinating to me, you're such in a far away place, and I think really the message was you were learning music, but your soul was searching.
Yeah.
And when it found this instrument, your passion just went 100% this direction.
Yeah.
And I've been watching some of your videos, and I can see you're into what you're doing, man. You know, it's a really good thing for what you're doing for music, and also keeping this instrument alive, you know, because it's not a lot of people know about it. You're taking it out of like a real bluesy kind of thing, keeping the blues, but making more modern and more kind of artsy, if you will, but keeping that blues psychedelic kind of thing going.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's awesome, man. You were also a street musician.
Yeah, that's right. I actually started busking on the streets in 2015. Mm-hmm. I was in New Zealand. I was living in Wellington by that time. Yeah, and
it's a beautiful part of the world.
Beautiful. I was in this course where I met Dan Antel. This guy was really important in my life because he introduced me to performing live on the streets, and I think was the one of the best schools. Every musician can have the experience to play in the streets because you need to be in control the dynamic setup that is in your environment, you know. So you need to feel what people is feeling as well, and you need to vibrate with them in a really fast way, and you need to see and watch out which things that you are playing are really attractive to the people.
That's right.
And that's how I started building my very first songs. Yeah, it was an amazing experience. So I was busking around in Wellington like 4 or 5 times a week with Dan Antel, that was an amazing violin player. Mm-hmm. And afterwards, we won a contest in Wellington. And that's where I started thinking, okay, maybe I can really do this. You know, I could do music for a living because it's going on well. And I think the very the important part of the trip was when I head to Papua New Guinea up north. This vibe from Papua New Guinea did actually mean coming back to the roots. That month and a half really influenced me as well. And this
did it influence you musically or to write songs or?
Yeah, musically write songs. Mm-hmm. My vibe in my project, you know, my focus on the project. Most of my lyrics are about traveling and get the most out of life, you know. So, and also I write, like 4 or 5 songs from the first album there. So yeah, that was the beginning of everything. It was such an important part of my life.
Wow.
Yeah.
And sure, I mean, what does music mean to you?
Music means a way to clearly and truly communicate what you have inside, deep inside, you know. And it's the only way for me to cross all these layers and expand what I feel, what I know, and what I need to communicate to other people in order to inspire them as well. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think that's for me.
I think also it sounds like from what you're saying that you get a lot of your musical inspirations from your surroundings and what you really see and what you take in. And as far as like being in Papua New Guinea, looking at the beautiful part of it, you can think of music right away and write something about it.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that's right.
I think that's fascinating, man. I really do. I think it's fascinating. And I like how you incorporate it like a slide, because some, you know, old schools, they play it like a guitar, right?
Yeah.
And kind of gives it a, like a, you know, Robert Randolph or a Derek Trucks kind of, you know, thing, you know. But I'm fascinated about what you do, man. And I really want you to teach me about your instrument. I mean, will you share your music with us on the show?
Yeah, sure. And let's do it.
Can I?
Please, that would be amazing. That would be my honor, man.
Yeah, it'd just be like a real short jam session, you know. But I really want the listeners at home to really feel what this instrument has to do. And this instrument, let's talk about this instrument is made from all recyclable materials. Tell us about that.
Yeah, that's right. So, in order to explain that, first, I start thinking about my mainstays, why I should do music, what will be my role in the music industry. So I was fascinated about the fact of have a sustainable music industry. When I went to big shows and concerts, you realize that there is a lot of work to do in order to get to a sustainable music industry. So if I could be part of that progress, I will do it. So I start thinking about the Cigarbox guitar and research a little bit, and of course you would build yourself a Cigarbox guitar, but you would never think about using recycled materials, you know, only the cigar box. So I start approaching in this way to build a cigar box that would include as much recycled materials as you can, and you still can find a really good tone in it. So I start building my first cigar box guitar with only $5. Was this little cigar box with, how you would say, like pine wood?
Pine wood?
Yeah, mm-hmm. Like really cheap pine wood that I would find in I don't know, somewhere like just laying down. Mm-hmm. And you have a screw in the nut, another screw on the bridge. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it was crazy. I was fascinated about the fact that I built something out using no money, and you would get this amazing tone. And I started developing that concept. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that was one of the mainstays. The other mainstay is approaching the people to recycle every day. So this instrument would fit perfectly with that. Mm-hmm. And the third one was approaching the people to connect with the nature. So this guitar have a lot of connection with the nature, you know, because you can feel the roots vibe in it, you know, and that's nature as well.
Yeah,
you don't need to have a tree on the guitar to mean that it's from the nature. So after thinking about it, I start building a lot of cigar box guitar with this approach. And of course, this guitar over here that is for big stages, it has, you know, a bridge that is better, a pickup that is better, but the whole instrument itself, I keep it simple. It's super simple. Most of it is recycled.
So anybody can do it?
Anybody can do it at home. Yeah. I have a couple of tutorials, you know, online. Uh-huh. And you can find a lot of stuff in YouTube nowadays. You can find a lot of knowledge in the cloud, so there is no excuses, you know, for not being doing something that is worth it.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's how I start approaching.
It's sound, right? It's that whole thing of being building an instrument and then becoming your instrument.
Yeah.
Like I started on pots and pans and furniture and whatever I can get sound out of, right? So it's about that soul searching and connecting with tone and vibration at the same time, you know. But when you build your own instruments, now we're talking like cajon, you know, like a box that you could bang on. You could build a box and play it as well. So I totally understand where you're coming from in terms of being emotional and spiritually attached to your instrument. Do you share your what knowledge you have with the new generation or younger kids, or you go around to schools and...
Yeah, that's right. We have this project that it's called Cigarbox School. And in Cigarbox School, we are developing a new kind of cigar box, mm-hmm. that I hope it will revolutionize the way we learn music.
Uh-huh.
And we are using 3D printing machines in order to...
Oh, cool.
Yeah, we are using technology...
Fantastic.
For us to build these new instruments with recycled filament, you know, the thing that you would use to print this part, and we teach the kids in only 40 minutes how to build their own recycled guitar, mm-hmm. only using a can of you know, Coke can, like a little can, and I forgot this word in English, escoba.
Escoba,
like a comb? Broom. Broom. Yeah, like so the stick.
Or the broomstick.
The broomstick, yeah. So I would use a little can, a broomstick, and a couple of other parts that we would print with the 3D printing, and you would get this amazing cigar box guitar in only 40 minutes.
Yeah, the broomstick is the traditional way, right?
Yeah,
two broomsticks with you know, maybe... Two or three strings at the most, right?
Yeah, two strings. The diddly bow is actually one or two strings, and we are doing this kind of diddly bow, but using these pieces that they would attach to any surface. It doesn't matter if you actually have a broomstick that is wider or is you know, more a little. Mm-hmm. You would fit with these pieces right away to the can and to the tuning upside.
Oh, that's incredible.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to see how this all will impact in a music education, you know. And I have been doing this since 2010, and you can see that children are nowadays, they are really connected with technology in a way yeah. that is starting to be worrying, and trying to prove, trying to encourage children to use their hands again. It's yes. something really
Very
meaningful.
Important. Yes.
It's not only about being sustainable. It's,
That's right.
It's about doing yourself, you know?
Yeah.
Doing it yourself.
My father taught me the same thing. I told him that I wanted to be a drummer, and he actually told me, if you want to be a drummer and understand drums, you have to take the drums apart and rebuild them to understand what goes into a drum set before.
That's right.
And I did. I took apart the drums and I said, you know, looked at everything and put everything back together again. And it brought a whole new appreciation on having my instruments, because now the instruments were more a part of me than ever, because I helped build the instrument, right? And made it better in different ways, right? And I used to flirt with, you know, making the drums sounding better by adding stuff or taking off stuff or, you know, drilling another hole. And I would always, you know, try to think of ways to make the sound
That's
better.
That's amazing. When you are part of that process, the music really gets you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, but at some point, you know, it's not the arrow, it's the Indian, you know. And no la flecha, es el indio.
Claro.
Yeah. And so what you have inside, your hunger, your passion, that's what's going to come through your instrument. I think that's the most important thing that our listeners know. But when you're building an instrument for yourself, what happens is you become one with the instrument that you have.
Exactly.
And then your possibilities are endless, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, totally. I totally understand. So now your music and your journey brings you to San Francisco. Are you working on any new music? What are you doing? Recording here, or are you just traveling the world? What are you doing?
So I'm here in San Francisco working in this really amazing project. It's going to be the new album of Cigarboxman, but it's not going to be another album, you know? It's, mm-hmm. It has a special meaning as mm-hmm. well. I have been working with Tomás Alcedo, mm-hmm. that is the lead guitarist from the project Fantastic Negrito, with La Fauna Music, and with High Street Studios, mm-hmm. and with a whole really amazing team, in order to get the connection from the nature in this album. So we decided to step out of the city mm-hmm. and head toward the nature. So we rent Airbnb in the middle of Bears Valley in November of 2020. That's when the journey began. And was snowing by that time in November.
Wow.
We were in this little tiny cabin up in the mountains, recording all the ideas that we got in from this connection. And was so beautiful and meaningful that we what we wanted to put this fire that the connection with the nature means for me, and express it on the tracks.
Yeah, to capture all the elements.
Exactly, to capture yeah. all the elements mm-hmm. that surround us. We came back to the city after, I guess, like 1 week recording there. We head back to the city and we start recording in High Street Studios. We record there all the other layers that you couldn't record up in the Birds Valley, mm-hmm. and the instruments, of course. And now I came back for more. So we actually went another time to the Birds Valley, but now it's summer. So it was really amazing how this Airbnb cabin looked in the winter time, and now how it looked in the summertime,
yeah, sure.
and how that influenced us in our way to compose music.
Wow! Okay.
And
the way your way to compose music. Yeah,
yeah. yeah. Mm-hmm. So it was mm-hmm. was amazing to have this contrast between winter and summer, mm-hmm. and so we were here for 4 days, and we came back. And we recorded at High Street with Thomas Pritchard on drums,
oh my.
With Uriah Duffy on
wow.
bass,
yeah.
and with Matt Wong on the keys, mm-hmm. and Nahuel Bronsini being the producer of the whole project, and David Saenz being the lead engineer and the video producer of the whole project, and has been an amazing journey. I am enjoying it so much so far, and yeah, I'm looking forward to see what will be the result of it and how we'll connect with our audience, you know, with our fans, and hopefully they will get as much from this connection as I get for myself, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can't wait to hear some of the new tracks. And sounds like you surrounded yourself with some great musicians and great areas of the country and the wilderness, and to inspire your music. I totally impressed by that. And Thomas Purgeon, what can you say? That's a, you know, there's levels and then there's levels.
Right? Yeah.
This guy, he's on another level, another planet.
Yeah, and no, that's amazing.
Incredible. I would love to have him on the show one day. So if you would, honest with Cigar Box Guitar, I would love to jam with you.
Let's do it. I would love to.
So we'll be right back with Cigar Box Man and myself on a little jam. Well, this is a special time right here. Before we get started, I want to share this instrument, this beautiful instrument, with our viewers and listeners, if you don't mind. Cigarito, break it down. Tell us how this instrument works here.
Yeah, first of all, you have the cigar box, of course. Is the main part of the body of the guitar. And it actually resonates pretty nice. This cigar box is made out from heavy wood. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I love it. That's why I choose this cigar box instead of another one. Then I try to do it with as much recycled materials as I can. Mm-hmm. First of all, I got this bridge that, how you say it in English, you just tell me the word.
Hinge.
So it was made of a hinge.
So the original bridge is a hinge.
It's a hinge, yeah,
okay,
that's
so
right.
The original bridge is a hinge.
A hinge.
So the strings come down the pipe and they get tied to the hinge.
Yeah, that's right. And afterwards, because I was playing too much in big gigs and it got out of tune real quick, so I put this bridge, for a string bridge.
So this is a modified?
Yeah, a modified version of the first one. I actually have changed the pickup a couple of times as well in order to get the tune. Mm-hmm. I start using single coils, and afterwards I move to humbucker. Mm-hmm. And yeah, the humbucker, I guess, it's like my best option to get the scream out of the cigar box.
Right.
Yeah. So I got here volume, tone, a couple of resonators. These resonators are made out of women's clothes, accessories.
Okay.
Yeah. Afterwards, we have the wood over here.
Yeah.
That is also recycled, and I got these marks.
What are the significance of the artwork there?
Yeah.
Can we get a close up on the artwork? What's the significance of this?
I'm not that good at reading music, so I decided to make my own musical notation. As the cigar box use open chords, and I played with a flask, so all the time I would play all the notes in one space.
So I
started to relation colors with the notes that I was getting. Mm-hmm. So now instead of thinking, okay, in this song I will play a C, an F sharp, or mm-hmm. a D, I would think I'm gonna play Britain, I'm gonna play Chile. I'm going to play water, I'm going to play zebra, I'm going to play flowers, I'm going to play dirt. So
yeah, that's ingenious.
That's my way of reading this instrument, you know, because, and also, as you can see, normally in the guitars you would find 1, 5, 7, and 9, you know, with the mark.
Okay.
I decided to make the 10th.
Okay.
Instead of 9, because it sounds, the 9 doesn't sound with my tuning. So
okay.
I mark the 10 and I follow like that.
You know? So you have your own structure there.
Oh yeah, I think that if someone wanted to play the cigar box, would be a little confusing at the beginning, because mm-hmm. it's another kind of notation with the colors and all that stuff. Yeah, but I mean, it works for me really well.
Well, I used to do the same thing as a kid. You know, I didn't know how to read music, so the way I would write music or the breaks, I would put, you know, patacón. Patacón, patacón guisao, or arroz con pan.
That's a good one.
Yeah. So we have to do what we have to do, right?
Yeah, of course.
And I can't tell you, this instrument sounds phenomenal. And so what are we gonna? We're gonna play a particular song today.
Oh yeah.
I requested a song. I like the song. Please tell our viewers what the title is.
Yeah, we are gonna play Cool Times in kind of African blues version.
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to it. Let's do it.
Please. Thank you.
Awesome, man.
Awesome, bro. Thank you so much, man. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for being here, man. We appreciate it. Well, there you have it, folks. This is what it's all about, sharing music, different cultures, but we're in the same mindset of healing people through music and inspiring people through energy and talent. We all have a little bit in us. Cigarito.
Dos Furitos.
Thank you, bro.
Oh, man. Really nice to meet you and being here with you.
Thank you, man.
Thank you.